Good morning. We are about ready to begin session three in our Religion and the Presidents series. And today we're going to deal with religion and the dawn of the modern presidency. And we will deal with William McKinley, Theodore Roosevelt, Woodrow Wilson, and Herbert Hoover. And so that we can get involved with all of this and get started, let's open with prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, again we thank you for the privilege of being able to reflect on the leaders that have guided and directed this nation. Lord, they have been a unique group of people that have brought varied and sundry gifts and talents. They have been people who have had deep faith and different ways of understanding who you are that have guided and directed the way they have led this country. We pray now, Lord, that you'll give us deeper understanding and appreciation of the lessons they have taught us in their leadership abilities. So be with us now as we reflect upon them in Christ's holy name. Amen. As the 19th century closes, and the 20th century dawns, cultural unrest in America gives rise to the progressive movement. This represents a great social reaction against the preceding Gilded Age. It consists of a moral, political, economic, and intellectual revolt that was not restricted to one party or class, but ran through the entire gamut of political and cultural groups. Nor was it a product of a single economic class. Farmers and laborers were at its core, but they were soon joined by multitudes from white collar and small business classes, and even by some very rich. It was a way of thought that separated an old from a new America. Major elements of progressivism included altered the standards of political honesty and public morals. It tried to redistribute wealth more equitably among all the nation's peoples. It modified the organization of government that had not changed since the Civil War. It demonstrated that the federal government had not changed, and it demonstrated that the government and its powers was the master of even the largest industrial combinations. Now, the political agenda included strong national regulation of interstate corporations, social insurance in times of injury, sickness, unemployment, and old age, constitutional reforms to reestablish and establish pure democracy, the role of government to serve public interests, universal direct primary system, direct popular election of senators, universal woman's suffrage, graduated federal income tax, prohibition of child labor, minimum wage for working women, and the review of judicial decisions. The first president that we'll look at today is William McKinley. He had a deep and devout evangelical faith that was powerfully influenced his life. After a conversion experience as a youth, he participated regularly in the worship and the ministry of the Methodist Church. He prayed and read the Bible daily and often testified to his faith in private and public, and consistently followed Christian norms. As president, McKinley habitually sought God's guidance in making decisions and devising his policies. His decisions to declare war against Spain in 1898 and to take control of the Philippines were strongly influenced by his faith and his assessment of the religious factors that were involved. Critics fault him for not properly distinguishing between piety and patriotism, and for arguing that America's actions served God's purposes. As a result of his upbringing, McKinley supported mission efforts and displayed great compassion for others most notably his semi-invalid wife, Ida. And he possessed a strong belief that God directed history and his own life, and he sought to base his policies on biblical principles and personal habits. He affirmed the divinity of Christ and argued that Christianity was the mightiest factor in the world's civilization. He was committed to the concept of manifest destiny, the conviction that it was America's task to Christianize the world. So what was the final verdict on William McKinley? Scholars argue over his legacy, but recently many have come to the consensus that he was a transitional president. He was the last to fight in the Civil War. He used his power as commander-in-chief broadly and creatively and increased the prestige of the presidency and expanded its powers, paving the way for his more activist successors. Some say he introduced the framework for the modern presidency. He brought experts and academicians into the government by appointing commissions. McKinley developed good relations with Congress by making it an equal partner in government and regularly consulting with leaders of both parties in crafting programs. His speaking tours and shrewd use of the press enhanced his personal popularity, giving him a powerful lever in public controversies. His political skills and experience, temperament, and tact enabled him to achieve many of his domestic and foreign policy goals. These same traits helped him heal a nation torn asunder by fratricide and continued hostile feelings from labor unrest in the early 1890s. Critics argue that McKinley promoted his own advancement, had no charisma, and rarely inspired the American people. He had a limited view of presidential power. Lacking speechwriters and a dramatic flair, he never explained his political philosophy in a compelling way. Despite these criticisms, other biographers offer generally positive assessments that McKinley was a high-bound Republican conservative, the spokesman for untamed business in the Gilded Age, the compliant agent of Mark Hanna, his political handler from Ohio, and an irresolute executive who could not prevent a needless war with Spain. A man of principle, an effective party leader, an astute politician, William McKinley increased the prestige and expanded the powers of the presidency. He exemplified traditional mainline Protestant Christianity of his era. His term was cut short by an assassin's bullet, which led to our next president, Theodore Roosevelt. The sage of Oyster Bay was an exemplar of manliness and what was called muscular Christianity, and an exceptional public servant who led a crusade for social justice. To his critics, he was a jingoist, a nativist, a hot-tempered, unpredictable fanatic, an egomaniac who put his own interests above America's good. Roosevelt, you hated him or you loved him. There were very few who stood in the middle. Roosevelt professed a faith in Christ at the age of 16 and joined the church. As a student at Harvard, he regularly taught Sunday school, and throughout most of his adult life, he faithfully attended church and read the Bible. A proponent of muscular Christianity, who depicted Jesus as a valiant soldier of righteousness, he encouraged the efforts of the YMCA to promote both sports and spirituality and supported the revivals of Dwight L. Moody. Reared in the Dutch Reformed tradition and under the strong influence of his father, T.R. avoided profanity, smoking, and gambling, drank alcohol sparingly, and eschewed premarital sex. Several tragedies had a great impact on him that shaped his approach to life. The premature death of his father from stomach cancer, and the deaths of his mother and his first wife in childbirth on the same day in February in 1884. Roosevelt insisted that the church must play a major role in reforming society, including improving living conditions and promoting justice for wage earners. The church, he said, must be a potent force in spiritual uplifting. He supported the spirit of the social gospel movement of the early 20th century. Roosevelt maintained that government must work to provide an even distribution of justice and pass legislation that was good for a nation as a whole. Good society could best be created by a public-private partnership that based national and individual life on individual biblical principles and promoted gradual but not radical change. He strove to use the government's power to take concrete steps to diminish social evils. Roosevelt's religious commitments are clearly evident in many of his policies, which led to the shaping of his new nationalism program, or what has been called the Square Deal. He approached the presidency with an extraordinarily activist approach. For him, if the Constitution did not expressly forbid him from taking a particular action or stressing or asserting a certain priority, then he did it. So his program included regulating trusts, supporting marriage, campaigning for workmen's compensation laws, taking a positive attitude toward blacks and minorities, intervening in international affairs, enacting pure food and drug laws, and initiating the first massive conservation program by putting aside national lands for preservation. Concerned about the nation's rampant moral decadence and materialism, he waged a crusade to defeat the malefactors of great wealth and elevate America's moral standards to save our own national soul. He took the unprecedented action by intervening personally as president to mediate the 1902 anthracite coal strike, and he took Panama to build an isthmus canal. He also took the unprecedented role as mediator in resolving the Russo-Japanese War, for which he won the Nobel Peace Prize, the first president to be so awarded that prize. Roosevelt endorsed the right of workers to organize to advance their welfare. The government must provide a square deal for both labor unions and corporations. In the interest of justice and fair play, however, it must inevitably sympathize with those struggling for a decent life rather than those who were fighting for larger profits. Roosevelt was a committed conservationist, not because it was politically popular, but because of his life experiences, love of nature, and belief that the president must be a steward of public resources. He strove to modify American behavior toward nature, worked to educate the public about social moral virtues of conservation, and tried to persuade citizens to pressure Congress to pass his policies. So what's the final verdict on Theodore Roosevelt? Flamboyant, dramatic, colorful, courageous, and brash, Roosevelt used his power as president to ensure that the world's greatest economic power played a more active role in global affairs. As William Allen White said, he was a man passionate, brave, generous, kind, and wise, a great heart that revived to righteousness a nation that was fattening in greed, languishing in iniquity. For Roosevelt, religion was more a matter of works than doctrine. Its evidence was in service and action and the way virtue shaped the common good. He remained a moral absolutist his entire life, a romantic who believed that most wrongs could be righted and all social ills had solutions. Without being able to formulate the reasons for my philosophy, he said, I am perfectly clear as to the philosophy itself. I want to be straight and decent man of good service and to realize the ideals of good government. God had raised me up to lead the nation in its desperate fight against illegal despotism of combined wealth in collusion with corrupt municipal, state, and federal office holders. In his fight, he changed the power, scope, and possibilities of the presidency. This leads us to perhaps the most famous Presbyterian president, Woodrow Wilson. He is the prime embodiment, the apogee, of the Calvinist tradition among the statesmen in the modern epoch. His forceful, eloquent speeches fusing political issues with Christian idealism and moral imperatives enabled Wilson to win the allegiance and confidence of many Americans. Wilson's faith is evident in his philosophy of government, his view of America's role in the world, and many of his major domestic and foreign policies, especially his attempts to mediate among the combatants of World War I, his decision to involve the U.S. in the war, and his role in devising the Paris Peace Treaties and the League of Nations. Calvinist covenant theology significantly shaped Wilson's worldview. Covenant theology stressed both God's authority and love. God was sovereign over the world's affairs, but he related to people in love, not arbitrary power. It insists that all life, including politics, must be based on God's justice and righteousness. Wilson completely absorbed his tradition's belief in the omnipotence of God, the morality of the universe, a system of rewards and punishments, and the supreme revelation of Jesus Christ. Wilson was socialized to believe in the importance of hard work, success, morality, and service. His Calvinistic roots helped him endow Wilson with dynamism, endurance, and courage. Like other committed Calvinists, Wilson believed that God was sovereign, just, and loving, that moral laws governed nations and individuals, that Jesus Christ was God's supreme revelation and humanity's redeemer, and that the Bible was the incomparable word of God and the rule of life. In terms of the role of the church, he embraced the old PCUS, Presbyterian Church of the United States, concept of the spirituality of the church, which was almost in complete opposition to organized social action by religious or political groups. This concept said that the church should seek to save souls and nurture individual faith rather than mobilize parishioners for political action or social improvement. He moderated this position as he supported the Federal Council of Churches later in his career. Wilson's New Freedom Program was ultimately informed and guided by his Christian faith. The domestic agenda included lowering tariffs, passing the income tax amendment, establishing the Federal Reserve Bank, creating the Federal Trade Commission, and supporting legislation to regulate the workday, an amendment for women to have the right to vote. In foreign policy, his relations with Mexico and his decision to become involved in World War I and mediate the Treaty of Versailles and the League of Nations are key achievements. From Wilson's perspective, America's mandate was not to increase its wealth and power, but to serve humanity, further morality, and promote peace, cooperation, and brotherhood. So what's the final verdict on Woodrow Wilson? Wilson's superior intellect, strong religious conviction, sense of destiny, integrity, boldness, and resolution made him at times a superb political leader. However, he possessed a rather rigid, dogmatic, self-righteous, insufferable personality that was often unwilling to compromise when he believed that his way was the right and true way. He also found it difficult to accept constructive criticism and could be very unforgiving and was known to hold grudges. To admirers, Wilson was a powerful prophet, a visionary, and the champion of the weak and oppressed. Wilson's faith in the goodness and rationality of men, in the miraculous potentialities of democracy, and in the inevitable triumph of righteousness sometimes caused him to devise quixotic or unworkable solutions. He stressed the essential nobility of men and assumed that human brotherhood and world order could be achieved. Wilson's higher realism almost always judged policies on the basis of whether they were right by Christian standards and not whether they brought immediate material or strategic advantage. Ignoring his own religious tradition's argument that no country was God's special agent, he portrayed the United States as a redeemer nation. His lofty hopes were dashed on the hard rocks of European power politics. Wilson challenged his world to exalt fraternity, sacrifice, democracy, and peace above fratricide, selfishness, autocracy, and warfare. Wilsonianism asserted that the United States would use its military power, economic resources, and cultural influence to try to advance the interests of the whole world, not just its own. His biographer, Arthur Link, put it, Wilson's work as president was informed, shaped, and controlled by insights that flowed from his Christian faith. The last president for today is Herbert Hoover. The Society of Friends, the Quakers, significantly affected Hoover's temperament and character, especially his sense of duty, work ethic, self-reliance, and abhorrence of display, and his worldview. Most notably, his emphasis on good works, private charity, and passionate pursuit of peace. His approach to the Great Depression was guided by Quaker concepts of ordered liberty and corporate individualism, and his belief that Americans respond generously to appeals to help to those in need. Born in West Branch, Iowa, Hoover was reared in a Quaker household, but was orphaned by age 10. He then moved to Newburgh, Oregon, and lived with an uncle. He attended and graduated in the first class at Stanford University as an engineer. His religious training taught him the importance of self-respect, self-reliance, and moral obligation, and convinced him that his conscience should guide all his activities. Quakerism is not a creedal tradition. While emphasizing personal piety and inward reflection adherence energetically worked to improve social conditions, eradicate social ills, and help the needy. Its most distinguishing characteristic is its stress on the inner light, also called the seed, the in-speaking voice, and the Christ within, the direct connection of each individual with the Creator. This inner light and the Quaker queries guided Hoover's thought and actions. Since their earliest days, Quakers are asked at their meetings if they opposed war, capital punishment, oaths, gambling, and discrimination, and if they supported education, temperance, prison reform, equality of the sexes, simplicity, religious tolerance, civil liberty, and just treatment of racial minorities. These queries expressed what Quakers thought Jesus would do if he lived in contemporary society and provided brotherly advice. Hoover, frankly, was not very interested in the devotional aspects of Quakerism, prayer, Bible reading, and meditation, but he was deeply affected by its way of conceptualizing the world, its principles for shaping both public life and private conduct. One biographer notes, Quakers' manners and methods were evident in Hoover's reticence, modesty, sympathy for the oppressed, gentleness and undiluted spirituality, high moral purpose, record of selfless service, and astounding audacity. He prized simplicity in both dress and demeanor. He wore plain, almost drab suits, had little interest in art, music, or fiction, spoke plainly, and relied on logic and reason to support his arguments. Hoover had a positive view of humanity. Echoing Emerson and Whitman, he contended that individualism stimulated productivity and protected liberty. It alone celebrated the universal divine inspiration of every human soul. The growing size and complexity of commerce and industry required government regulation to prevent unfair business practices. Government's role was to safeguard equality of opportunity and to permit individual ingenuity. Hoover is best labeled as an associational progressive or a corporate liberal, and the best title for his philosophy is cooperative capitalism. He believed that trade associations, labor unions, farm cooperatives, professional societies, chambers of commerce, and marketing organizations could best synthesize individual entrepreneurship and corporate enterprise and promote economic prosperity, social justice, and equality of opportunity. The role of the federal government was to assist in research and development, mediate between conflicting groups, and sometimes regulate their activities. Hoover argued that voluntary organizations should play the leading role in alleviating suffering, aiding the poor, and promoting economic development. Inspired by Quaker principles and his own life experiences, during his presidency, he pursued progressive policies in child welfare, the treatment of Blacks and Native Americans, penology, civil liberties, conservation of forests and petroleum, and public power. He negotiated agreements between business and labor to preserve wages and prevent strikes, discouraged hoarding, arranged for credit for farms and home mortgages, and created the Reconstruction Finance Corporation to aid banks and businesses. In foreign policy, he worked to reduce naval armaments, ensure the economic stability of European governments, and improve relations with Latin American nations. So, what's the final verdict on Herbert Hoover? He was a quintessential problem solver, but rejected the idea that the federal government could solve all the nation's ills. Despite his compassionate, humanitarian impulses, many considered him cold and indifferent to the plight of a suffering nation. His stoicism, lack of outward emotion, and inability to communicate his concern effectively alienated Hoover from the electorate. Because of his personality and experience, Hoover saw the president as more an administrator than a leader. He was unable to convey the principles and the policies he championed. He was a poor speaker who could not connect with suffering America in its time of despondency and despair. Hoover's Quaker roots simply did not equip him with the worldview or the approach needed to deal with the challenges of the Great Depression. He stressed the key virtues of greater thrift, simplicity of desire, and neighborly charity. His Quaker convictions led him to emphasize self-help, community involvement, and private relief. His calls for friendly cooperation and self-sacrifice fell on deaf ears. The times were not right for his plan to create a socially responsible corporatism based on voluntarism and associationalism among countervailing business, labor, and farm groups. His Quakerism enabled him to blend the practical and the ideal. Hoover was a highly respected engineer, an exceptional humanitarian, an astute manager, a devout public servant, a prominent proponent of peace. His solid administrative skills, intellectual rigor, boundless energy, and strong sense of calling enabled him to achieve success in both business and government. He exemplified persistence and moral principles, especially integrity, compassion and desire to help others, not craving power, motivated Hoover's public service. Addicted to hard work, rigidly self-disciplined, and motivated by spiritual idealism, he was often gruff, usually very serious and stubborn, and rarely seemed to be enjoying himself. He espoused a peculiarly American brand of individualism and uncompromisingly defended personal freedom. So we have Herbert Hoover. As we look at the quotations, let me be a little clearer about the breakout who said what this week. William McKinley's quotations are, in handout number 3, 1 through 7 relate to William McKinley. Quotations number 8 through 15 relate to Theodore Roosevelt. And the quotations 16 through 22 relate to Woodrow Wilson. And quotations 23 to 26 relate to Herbert Hoover. Now, as you look over them very briefly, you see very, very clearly the influence of Christianity on William McKinley and the fact that he really sees manifest destiny and how Christianity guides and directs who he was and the purpose of this nation and the policies that directed who he was as president and how we function as a government. So it's interesting to see how that is woven into his self-understanding and worldview. As you look at Theodore Roosevelt, very interesting that for him, life is meant to be a life of service and how we can better the lives of the country and each other. And you really see the crossover effect about how our religious conviction leads us to be able to reach out and serve each other. you have a similar kind of underlying effect of religion in terms of the covenant theology that comes through Woodrow Wilson. You can certainly tell that he is a Presbyterian as you see the impact of covenant theology, the Bible, and the role that is to be played by faith and leadership in terms of the role he played as president. And then you see with Herbert Hoover how as a Quaker he understood his role of leadership in quotations 23 to 26. As you read through these statements, we'll talk about them in more depth when we deal with our Zoom discussion. I hope this has been helpful as we look at the formation of the new century and the evolution of the modern presidency. This is a little edit for session three, dealing with the handouts were William McKinley, Theodore Roosevelt, Woodrow Wilson, and Herbert Hoover. As you look at the statements 1 through 7, you get a real flavor of how William McKinley understood his faith, guiding and directing everything he did as president. Now, he embraced what is basically called manifest destiny. And 4 through 7 really gives you a sense of how he combines piety and patriotism. He saw it the mission of this country to spread Christianity and Christianize the world. And that was really the thing that drove his leadership and his understanding and his worldview. And you really get a sense of that as you look at those statements. When he was assassinated in 1900, Theodore Roosevelt took over. And at that point, and it still is the case today, he was the youngest president ever to assume office. And he was an action-oriented guy. Number 8 gives you his understanding of what he was called muscular Christianity. And note, for him, religion wasn't a matter of saving your soul. It was a matter of leading you to make a difference in life and for your fellow human being. It was, how do you make the world a better place? That was the purpose of Christianity. It was the purpose of how you live your life. That's what faith leads you and motivates you to do in this world. And that was pretty much a service-oriented notion of how faith guides and directs who you are in life. Note number 10, the Decalogue and the Golden Rule were the foundation for him of how you make the world a better place and for social and political life. For him, that defines Christian citizenship. And note, he really was about how you become the preacher of Christianity, the preacher of social justice, the one who is out front advocating how you make society and the world a better place. I thought it was fascinating. Number 13, how for him, worship is a place where you plug in to gain strength, to gain energy, to gain what you need as an individual to fight moral evils that you have to confront in this world. And for him, again, the social fabric of modern states has no sure foundation in the Bible, number 15. He really sees the Bible as the foundation upon which you build a moral structure and the society as a whole, give you direction and guidance. And he was one, as I said in the presentation, who really was someone who endorsed the essence of the social gospel movement in the early 20th century. 16 through 22 are statements that are associated with Woodrow Wilson. He is an unabashed Presbyterian that has great confidence in the providence and sovereignty of God. And when you read these statements, that jumps right out at you.
Basically 16, faith in God's providence sustains me more than anything else has, can. He says that in more than one place. He really is Presbyterian through and through. He comes from the old Southern Presbyterian Church. He calls the Bible the Magna Carta of the soul. And essentially for him, he believes that spiritual renewal leads to material renewal. And it's critical for him in terms of the two going together. And it's really sort of fascinating that he really has confidence in providence and faith. And that sort of undergirds everything that he does in life. He's not like some of the other presidents that we've looked at that bases their whole worldview on reason and faith. He believes that you really have to rely more on faith and providence, where if you rely more on reason, you set yourself as the final arbiter of what is true and what is right. It's fascinating as you see that, he said in 22, I do not see how anyone can sustain himself in any enterprise without prayer. He really is one who endorses all of the orthodox understandings of the Reformed tradition. 23 to 26 are basically statements that are associated with Herbert Hoover, talking about coming from Quaker stock. And when you read these statements, you really get a sense of the Quakers' reliance on conscience and on their ability to care for others. The idea that conscience should lead you to voluntarily be able to help your neighbor in need. And also undergirded, as we heard in the presentation, that Quakers really were about being able to, on your own, care for others without necessarily having government intervention. That was basically inbred in the worldview of Hoover that really worked against his leadership for the Great Depression. Now, he was a man of great honesty, integrity, a man of great philanthropy, but the fact that he depended on that to come from one's own initiative really fell short of how the government could basically be a part of resolving human need and the tremendous crisis that emerged from the factors and forces that were a part of the Great Depression. But you really get a sense of who he was when you read these statements and the Quaker background and influence that guided and directed him. So look these over very carefully as you get a sense of these individuals and where their faith fit in for their leadership. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for this time together and for these unique individuals who serve to lead our nation and guide us in ways that helped us to grow in our understanding of who we are. Be with us now and bless us in the week ahead. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.